Hey guys, welcome back. It's James here, and the last time we were recording, we were just about to enter Bahamut's cave because we were working on side quests before we entered the final dungeon. And with that, we're just gonna head right in. So the trash in this dungeon, or side dungeon or whatever you want to call it, the trash isn't that bad, and there is some good armor pickups that you can get here. I believe it's for Kane, but the big gimmick, other than the boss, is that in pre-selected points, you will have to fight a behemoth, which is kind of like a mini-boss on its own, and I believe there's like five of them. So I just found some more samurai armor that Edge already had, or not Edge, Kane. So we're gonna give it to, wow, yeah, Cecil's had the diamond armor like for a long time now. So we're gonna give it to Cecil. So the XP in here is pretty good, and you get like an insane gil from all the fights. Insane amount of gil from all the fights. Get the samurai shield, place that out. And this is the final party, at least in the Super Nintendo version. Like, this is it. This is what you're stuck with the rest of the game. In the Game Boy Advance, PSP, and I think DS versions. Actually, I'm not so sure about the DS version. I can't remember. Later on, you can go back to Mysidia. You go to where everyone's praying, and all the party members are there, and you can pretty much swap everybody out, even the older characters like Edward and Yang and all them, Palm and Porm, and they all have their own side quests to get really good gear as well. The Red Giants give pretty good gil and XP, but the problem is they do a ton of AoE damage and they can self-destruct. It's just not really worth it. The D-Bones, the Dragon Bones, they are weak to Holy. So with Excalibur, you kind of rip right through them. I believe we have our first behemoth coming up when we go across this little pathway, this bridge. There it is. So the strategy with behemoth is you do not want to cast magic on him, and every time you melee him, he counterattacks. So the of a physical attack, so you want to have everyone kind of blinked up. Or as they would call it in FF11, it's a semi. Actually, I think Rydia can do summons and he won't counter, but if you try to nuke him with really powerful magic, he will wreck your party. So we want to protect the casters. And Kane will be in the air most of the time, so that kind of works out. Now, the blink spell in this can absorb 3 hits, and then you have to recast it. Never mind, I guess Tan only does 1. Now, if you can manage to paralyze Behemoth with Rydia's melee, that's really handy. I'm gonna wait for Kane to land. 65,000 gil, 12 grand XP, not too shabby. And once they are killed, they are permanently removed from that spot. It's not like if you go downstairs and come back upstairs, you have to deal with that again. Now on this path, we have where the rest of the behemoths are. Berserk Cecil just get a ton more damage in. Yeah, Behemoth just punched Kane for 1600. He hits pretty hard. Tearing through it now. There we go. Unfortunately, we have to heal Kane up because he got haymakered. Rose is running a little low, so let's give her an ether. As I had mentioned, when you slay the behemoths, they're permanently gone from this area. So even if you have to leave the dungeon, rest in the ship, get all your HP and MP back, and then return, they will still be gone. And because you're not using for anything else, Cecil can still heal, but his healing does not scale at all. It's pretty terrible compared to Rosa. This is the last of the behemoths. Something else that you can do also is you can berserk Cecil and then just pretty much defend with everyone else, so the only time the behemoth is counterattacking is against Cecil. And Rydia, or rather Rosa just learned white, which is actually the translation for holy. So now Rosa has the capability to nuke things pretty hard. Excuse me. So we've been saving up our ethers for a long time now. I think we can spare some, whoops, not for him, for Rosa. Should be good. So we have arrived to the Lord of Summons, Bahamut. So when you talk to this girl here, she says, oh, you're a half, and she's referring to half Lunarian, half human. Let's just check everything. Now, kind of like Odin, this is another summon battle that you are on a timer. You basically... So, like in traditional, like in all of his Final Fantasy games, Bahamut does Mega Flare as his, like, super attack. And you need to get Reflect on all your party members, or at least some of them, to survive before it goes off. To not only survive it, but it will nuke back the damage onto him. But you kind of want to kill him before Mega Flare gets off, so it's kind of up to you how you want to go about it. So he says, you have defeated Leviathan, but it could have been done without the power of light. Whether you possess the true light or not, I, Bahamut, the king of us monsters, will judge you. And off we go. So because we need a ton of damage pouring out, we are going to throw some of these items that we've been hanging on to. Kind of laying some damage. We are going to do Virus because it's the fastest casting spell. And we're going to start getting our Reflect wall, our Reflect spells going. Now we are leveled up a bit, so we may be able to get him before he gets it off, but we'll see. So we got 2 turns, or 2 seconds, or whatever you want to call it left. Let's get it on Iridia. And you can time it so that King jumps while Mega Flare goes off. Looks pretty cool when he does Mega Flare. He unfolds his wings just like this. Kane is in the air, so he survives. So for some reason, even though Rosa had Reflect on, the Mega Flare still went through. But Tussle, Iridia, and Kane survive. So Bahamut says, I have indeed seen your strength and will. You can call my name whenever you need my help, Iridia. He is the most powerful summon in the game. He does a ton of non-elemental nuke damage. And we're going to exit out. With that, we are going to rest out. Oops. There we go. And now we are going to head towards the final dungeon in the game. We have to take the same path we took when we initially went to the Crystal Palace and we were getting Fusoya. We got poison up a bit, but we are kind of being reckless just by speeding through. That is the effect of being poisoned. Those look kind of neat to me. Let's get all our HP and MP back. And actually, before we go inside, we're gonna save again. So we see all the crystals are gathered here. You can talk to them. And they all kind of give you a bit of advice. Like, you will find weapons that once endangered the lives of the Lunarians sealed with Zemus below. Kind of giving you a hint that there's a bunch of treasure you want to go after. The Tower of Babel was destroyed and Zemus' field has been lifted. So that particular crystal said that they saw Fusoya and Golbez go inside. All the crystals are using their power to remove the shield. This one says even though Fusoya is very powerful, he's going to have a hard time fighting against Zemus, who has increased his psychic abilities. And we're gonna go inside. Now this dungeon is much larger than the previous dungeons we've been in, kind of fitting for being the final dungeon. Also kind of fitting to have that awesome Baron music kick in, the Red Wing music. So we are after a lot of treasure in here. Take one step into our random encounter. Been a while, so it might run into some loops or having to do a lot of backtracking. Get the flame whip. The Dragoon set is, guess what, the best gear for Kane. As I said just a moment ago, I may get lost. It has been a while. And I want to make sure I get all the really good loot. Got the Jigoon helmet. Body piece. Yeah, the gear isn't that scattered about, but we pretty much just got all Kane's armor. And that leads to a dead end, so we're gonna head back. I think I'm getting a little too far ahead, so we're gonna head back after we run away from those guys. Oh, So we're gonna learn Tornado, which unfortunately isn't that handy, but... Got a monster in a box, which isn't too bad. Just these normal monsters, nothing out of the ordinary. Get some level ups. And we got the life staff. I'm trying to remember. I know if you use the staff as a weapon, like use it as an item, you can raise someone, so we're gonna actually keep the silence one, because if she melees and it procs, it's pretty handy. Okay, so we see a weapon hovering in the distance, and that is our first mini-boss. So we are going to heal up and get ready. They usually have little intros, like this says, go to the eternal gloom of Dark World before you can touch this blade. We have the Pale Dim, which I believe is supposed to be a white dragon. And he likes to counterattack with the slow spell. Now before, I was talking about life too, I think in the last video, this is where it comes in handy, because she can just get edged right back up. Berserk Cecil to give him some speed and additional attack power. Now we're gonna give him some haste. Just like that, he is gone. And we got one of Edge's ultimate weapons, the Murasame. Body cured up a bit. That'll do. Gonna head back to the entrance. Now we went south and we went west, but I don't think we've gone east yet. There's one giant down. And two. Gives us Edge's, I believe, best body piece. Now the cool thing about this being the last dungeon is you basically, I mean, within reason, you can just blow through all your items because this is what you've been saving them up for. You won't need, I mean, you can save a few of them for the last boss, but you don't have to save like everything. Actually, while we are here, we can pop out really fast. Just gonna get all our MP back, and then we're gonna go right back in. Oops, going way too fast. Save our game. Almost at 750,000 gil. In case we wanted to buy a bunch of ninja stars or blow it all on elixirs or something like that. Hard to pass up on the warlocks because they're really easy and they get a ton of XP. You're now on floor B4. Entangle can get quite annoying, and I gotta be a little more careful when I encounter the gold dragons. Actually, let's take them on. Their blitz attack is pretty random, not when they cast it, just how much damage it does. It's pretty odd, I don't know if it's heavily scaled against magic resist or what. Another elixir. Now there is a blue dragon and a red dragon. Those guys are pretty annoying and you have to be careful. But other than that, monsters here aren't too bad. doorway to the left, but we're gonna pick up this chest real quick. And you'll notice sometimes when we run away, it'll say like, oh, you dropped 500 gil, oh, you dropped 5,000 gil. But I mean, these guys are dropping like 20,000 gil per fight, so it's not that big of a deal. Behemoth, although now it's just normal battle music instead of the boss music that we had earlier. And we'll just apply the same strategy, although Edge hits way harder now, so these should be dropping pretty fast. Stardust Rod. Now we've been using the whip the entire game, but I do like to give her the Stardust Rod. Kind of running out of room here. She can do an AoE combat ability, kind of like how Palm and Porm's twin attack was when you use the item. Out the window. Hope that's where we came from. Now if you look to our right, you can see a sword being, I mean, it's just chilling there, but we are gonna go after that eventually. Here's our first blue dragon. Learn Nuke, which is our second most powerful spell in the game. So we have the blue and the red dragon. We're just gonna do the blue dragon first. Red Dragon has a double attack, which can get kind of frustrating. Here, I'll call Bahamut out. Kind of help us out a bit. Not too bad. We got Cecil's best shield, the crystal shield. Got the protect ring. Actually, we are going to give that to Rosa. Before we move on, I'm gonna kind of use use up some of these items, because we're running out of room. Haven't sold gear in, like, forever. Focus on the top dragon first. Cecil just took a hit. Now, the scary thing is when they do Blizzard and then that Heat Ray at the same time, but we're gonna get everyone back to speed. That should finish him off. 130,000 gil. Not bad. So we got Cecil's Gauntlet, which is the Crystal Gauntlet, the best one. Let's see, we can use an Aether 2 for her. We have the Holy Robe, although it's called white here. Alright, have to backtrack just a second. Went a bit too fast. Looking for that loot. We have another monster in a box here. Got Cecil's crystal breastplate. She just leaves the helmet. The reason we need to free up room is because more gear is going to be dropping, so we can get rid of these. Get rid of the flame whip. And we can go back to where we were. Got his crystal helm, which finishes off Cecil's gear. The blue and red dragon, as far as non-boss monsters go, but have gear, the blue and red ones are probably the most dangerous. These guys like to cast Doom on your characters, so it's a good idea to just run away. And they don't give that much XP. Thank you. Got a cabin. Now, I do believe there's a save point coming up, which we want to reach just for some safety and get everyone's HP and MP back. It's also a great spot to grind if you have some last minute leveling to do. So you can continue on going the right path, or if you take this hidden path to the left, you can go after more treasure. As you can see, you should not be able to walk through there, but that is why it is, quote, hidden. Got another behemoth. And we got another protect ring, which we can put on Rydia. Now this wasn't the save point I was referring to, but it is still pretty handy, because we've been doing quite a lot without saving, so let's use a cabin. And we will press on, and we have reached this secret area where the sword was from earlier that I mentioned, which brings up another mini-boss. This is the power of the sword which Master Zemus detests shall not be released. And we have a wyvern, which in the other versions I believe is called Dark Bahamut. And the fight starts off right away with a giant nuke like that. So we are going to get Edge up, and then Rose is going to cure 4. So even though Edge just took a hit, we are going to Berserk Cecil so you can start wailing in on him. Get a Bahamut going. Let's really lay into him. He's got a Life Seed going for Edge. The 10,000 damages from Rydia's Bahamut is just so nice to have to really rush the boss down. So with that, we get the Crystal Sword for Cecil, which is his ultimate weapon. In most versions, it is called the Ragnarok. I don't even know why I'm really healing up. We're just going to use another tent as soon as we get in. And let's save up. And press onward. Before we went to the left, which was to lead this way. Now we're gonna go down the right set of stairs. See, so it's pretty hard now. Got the heroin robe, and I thought the holy one was the best. Let me check the stats on that. Yeah, that shot up her stats pretty nicely. I'll have to look into that. That's pretty interesting. So we are kind of in the final stretch here. We do have a save point coming up. I believe it's this first room. Maybe a mistake. Yeah, there we go. Now these next few fights can be tricky. They do have some gimmicks that can go haywire, but let's use a cabin. I mean, usually, at this point, the strategies are typically the same, just berserking, keeping everyone healthy, and nuking with the helmet. This is for the Holy Lance, I believe. Which is, obviously, Kane's legendary weapon. Woe to those who seek to gain the Lance of White, which would be Holy. This is on a timer, so we're going to do everything we can just to nuke him down. Yeah, Rosa just nuked for 6,000. Now, him doing fast does nothing, it actually helps you out. And there he goes. Now, some other tricks you can do, that was kind of risky what I did. Some tricks you can do is you can, when he casts Doom on one of your party members, you can kill one of your own party members, which gets rid of the debuff, and then you raise them, which will cause a trigger in the game to make the monster re-doom everybody, which resets their timers back to 10. That's in case you're lower level or you just don't have the damage output in order to kill him in time. So we're gonna get rid of the Gungnir. I was looking for Holy, that's fine. There we go. Now this Trickster is just a normal monster. As his name suggests, he likes to trick you. He will constantly peep himself, making you want to cast Thunder because it says he's weak to it. But you just burn him down. First use a tent. Save our game. And we're gonna press on. We have two treasure chests here, but we cannot get to them. It says the sacred ribbon shall not be within your hands. The ribbon is a iconic Final Fantasy headpiece or accessory that prevents status ailments from hitting your characters. So we have two lunar dragons. Now Now they are weak to holy, as you just saw. Cecil just ripped into them for 10k. Final stretch with some awesome music. There are some treasure chests scattered about. I think they usually have like either free items or they have ninja stars. Gotten that drop before, that is pretty strange. The firebomb, which is what Cecil uses at the very beginning of the game when he's riding the airship and encounters the first monsters. Bottom right, there is another legendary weapon. It says, you think that you, the ones from the blue planet, can handle this blade of black, the Masamune. And this fight, as you can hear from the water, is a dark leviathan type creature, but I think it's called the Ogopogo, that's right. He does two big waves, which lays on a ton of that damage. But we're going to instantly do a cure 4 to get everyone up to speed. And we are just going to cure everyone every turn, just to preemptively keep everyone going. Probably gonna knock out Cecil, so let's get him back up. Let's call Bahamut. And let's get another Cure 4 bomb going. And we got him. Lots of AoE damage that fight. That Edge has completed his legendary weapons. Just get everyone up. We're gonna gonna give some ether 2s to Rosa. Let's give Edge his sword. Let's dump these in the garbage, free up some room. We're going to still continue to fight most of these monsters just to edge out some levels before we reach the end. A whistle all the way at that point, really? I don't remember that either. I mean, I say it a lot. And that calls the fat chocobo. Wow, that would have been really handy, seeing as I can give him all this garbage. I feel kind of silly with that now, but yeah, that would have been handy. So let's give him all this stuff. And that should be good enough. Thanks, Fat Chocobo. I guess that comes in handy right when you're near the end. In case you're still hunting for all this stuff, or if you want to go back and you miss some gear. Get some more ninja stars. I believe they're tax stars for Edge. They just call them ninja. Why not? This is 3 red dragons. I guess the Super Nintendo couldn't handle 3 of them, so they just said, what the heck, we'll just pile them on top of each other. Version of them, it's the red one. Unfortunately, they're just not really worth the time to engage. And this brings us to our final cutscene for the game, if you'll call it that. So we see that Golbez and Fusoya are about to jump into combat with Zemus, and they start trying to nuke him. I always liked that Golbez got his like own character sprite right over there. So they pretty much toss everything at him. Debuffs, holy, the tier 3 elemental spells. Then Fusoya says, do the meteor now. And then Golbez says, I'm ready. So they kind of do a palm form twin attack, W meteor. And then Zemus says, this is just the beginning. Like this face plant. So Gobet says, "We defeated him. What a pity. He was consumed with evil and could not use his powers for good." So then I guess they didn't notice we were right behind him, cheering them on. They do celebrate just a little too early as Zemus starts moving about and turns into a creature. He says, "I'm the absolute dark substance product of Zemus's hatred. He is Zeramus, the hatred." And then Fusoria says, "Death only increased Zemus's hatred." Gotta be really inconvenient. And then Golbez says, "Zeramus, I shall cast you back to where you belong." So they re-engage with him. And right off the bat, Golbez drops a meteor on him, which heals him for 10,000. Same thing with Soya. So meteor's healing him, kind of out of luck. So Fusoya says we need to use the crystal. And then Zeramus says, "You, the man of darkness, using it does nothing." He then returns the meteor spell and it instantly knocks out both of them. Says, "Suffer and perish, my hatred will last until I destroy all. Now it's your turn, come into the darkness." So things are in pretty rough shape, but the game decides we're going to go back to Mysidia to where all our friends are waiting. Porm and Palom notice that they can kind of sense that they're in danger. So the Elder says, "Now is the time to wish for the Earth, Palom, Porm. We shall send people's wishes to Cecil." And everyone kind of bows their head and unites in prayer for Cecil and the crew. As they pray, Cecil gets up, and he goes towards his brother, and Golbez hands him the crystal. And Cecil calls him out, and he calls out Zeramus, and says, "For all those living on the Earth, I will destroy you." So we get this battle, where everyone's prayers are kind of showing up for Cecil, strengthening him in the group. I always thought the background to this battle was, like, freaking awesome. And then as more and more of the former party members and all that show their support, Cecil's party gets up, they get raised, they get their health back and all that. And then lastly for Cecil, we have Fusoya and Golbez who give him the blessings from the moon. Now at this point, you can't do anything to Zeramus. He doesn't take damage and all that, so to get the fight going, we need to use the crystal as an item. Since Cecil is a paladin and has the light, it is very effective against Zeramus. And that's the catalyst for which sends us into the final battle against Zeramus. And we get some awesome music. And we get right into it. So with Edge, we're going to be throwing our most powerful weapons, such as Excalibur, at him to do damage. we're going to be calling in Bahamut. If we need to use recovery items like elixirs and such, we will be doing that. And Kane will typically either support with items or he will jump in the air to avoid AoE attacks such as the Big Bang attack. And as you can see, some of these thrown items like the Gungnir and all that, they're hitting for anywhere between 5,000 to 8,000. Bahamut hits for 10,000. Now when he does Big Bang, everyone needs to get a cure for right away. Or we have to give them a life in case it took too much damage. Kind of a rinse and repeat. It doesn't make too much sense to cast haste and all that stuff because Xeromist can do black hole, which will negate all the buffs put onto your party. What we got left. We got some of the ninja stars. We can throw the light sword. And even if you haven't taken damage, it's a good idea to start casting Cure 4 just to preemptively get your guys healed in case he does Big Bang between the casts. So Ridia alone, I think this is the third or fourth Bahamut. She's done like 30 to 40,000 damage. Not too bad. When Xeromist starts casting Meteor, that means he's getting low on health. And fortunately, his Meteor is not as insane as it is throughout the rest of the game, or else it'd be pretty unfair. Edge. We're going to get Light 2 going for Ridia. Kind of get everyone caught up. Four off so we don't lose Rosa to a Big Bang. There's the Meteor. It's probably going to do somewhere like 500 damage. Okay, 800. And with that, Xeromist is slain. Now, the major contributing factors to winning that fight was my guys are pretty high level. We did get all the legendary gear, and Rosa constantly heals. And the reason we do that is if he does Big Bang, Rose is busy doing something else. There is a chance that Zeramis will just big bang again, and it will cripple your party incredibly fast. You might lose, like, everyone but Cecil and Kane, and then you have to hope you can catch up back in time. And a pretty smooth fight. Tons of damage from, Rydia and Edge. Zeramis, I will not perish as long as they're evil. There is evil in the hearts of people. Then he disappears as he perishes. And then Fusoya says, well done. I didn't know you people had such power. Your people might have been further along than us Lunarians. And then Fusoya explains that just as we have both good and bad in our hearts, just as there are crystals of light and darkness, the ground and the underground, but as long as evil exists, there will be good to challenge it. So while they celebrate, Fusoya does say, I must now return to my sleep. How about you? Cecil said we're going to go back to the planet because there's people waiting for us. Which does leave Golbez, and Golbez says, may I go with you? I cannot go back to the Earth considering what I have done, and he would like to see his father's people. Fusoya says, if you wish, but it will be a very long sleep. And Golbez thanks Cecil for calling him brother. I know you can't forgive or forget what I've done for causing so much pain. And Cecil doesn't really have a response. And so he's like, well, we gotta go. So everyone tells Cecil that this is probably the last time he's gonna see Golbez for a while, if ever. So he should probably say something. So Cecil says goodbye, brother. And with that, the Lunarians return to their sleep. Well, Fusoya and Golbez. We have the Mycidian legend, which appears. In addition to that, it also says the moon has just started to seek for its own light. And once they've returned to Earth, you can see that the big whale has fulfilled its purpose, so it returns to the sea. And we kind of get cutscenes showing everyone catching up to their normal lives. Pollum is trying to flirt with girls and boast about himself while the elder is giving off a lesson. Then we go to Eblin, where we see Edge has taken over role as the king. But more than anything, Edge misses Riddim. Rydia has returned to the land of the summons, where King Leviathan and Queen Asura are praising her. That Yang as well has become the king of Fabul and has his wife at his side. I believe the former king is now his advisor. But despite being king, Yang still goes out with his students for the martial arts training. Edward returns to Demacian to rebuild his kingdom. We then see King Geon with daughter. After all the battles with the Red Wings, they are rebuilding their castle as well. So the king says, "I received good news. Cecil will ascend the Baronian throne with Rosa, and that they are invited to their ceremony." And as I was mentioning way at the beginning of this series, we see Kane at the mountaintops without his helmet with his long blonde hair. And Kane says, "Forgive my absence, I must strengthen myself to be a true Dragoon before going back." So there, we do then see a couple of astrologers who are looking into outer space, and one exclaims that the moon is acting pretty weird. Which we then return to Baron, and we see Cecil and Rosa with all these flowers in their room. And with that, the moon acting weird, Cecil says he could have swore he heard his brother's voice, but wasn't sure. So all the heroes return to Baron to meet up with Cecil and Rosa, who are now the king and queen. This part, when I proposed to my wife Kayla, this was something I thought about like a long time ago, but it was always that I wanted, this kind of reminded me of what I wanted, although not quite exactly like this, but I had all my friends and family there, and we did end up playing the Final Fantasy IV theme of love, which is typically the song played between Rosa and Cecil, so it turned out pretty well. I really enjoyed it. So we have most, just about everyone's here. Edward has arrived. And then I think the last character is Ridian. And with that, everyone lines up all nice and neat. And everybody starts cheering as Cecil and Rosa are married. And that concludes this playthrough. It was really fun to do. I've been wanting to do it for a long time. This was my first Final Fantasy, and it is pretty much my favorite, alongside Final Fantasy Tactics, as far as the offline ones go. I mean, I also love all the other ones, especially like 6, 12, and I really enjoy the other ones too, like, you know, 9 and 10. I've never played Final Fantasy 2, like the actual Japanese 2 or 3, never got into those, which I should try out sometime. But anyways, I mean, this was a blast to play through. If you have any questions, you can comment, I'll do my best to help you out. This showed most of the content except for the Sylph Cave, which is not that difficult at all. So yeah, I'm gonna try to figure out what my next playthrough is while I start working on Octopath Traveler. No, this, like I said, this was a ton of fun. So thank you very much for watching. I'm gonna wrap this up and take it easy, guys.